Well, what does this world look like? Really, what does everywhere look like when we interact with it? How does it differ from our interactions with computation on a device such as a Keio, computation on a PC? Well, here's a guy who's using a personal computer. I know this guy pretty well, so I'm fairly confident that I can describe his internal state as he's using this personal computer. And we see that he is directly engaged in this. He has chosen this interaction. He sat down and he opened up a computer and he turned it on and he chose his application and he is presenting himself to the world through a series of very conscious, very chosen actions over which he has entire agency. We see the classic personal computer one-to-one relationship between him and the device. There is not a constellation of other devices in his environment. There is merely the PC, and the PC has to be everything to him. This is very interesting, to me anyway. His body is completely irrelevant to this interaction. I mean, he could be standing on his head, and as long as he's able to type with his feet, you'd never know it if you were interacting with him. His body is immaterial to the way that he uses this device and to the way that he's perceived by people on the other side of that interaction. His body is a cipher. It has been removed from the equation. And for all of these reasons, he has a very interestingly high degree of control over the presentation of self. Presentation of self is a phrase that was first used by a sociologist named Irving Goffman in 1958 in a book called The Presentation of Self in Everyday Life. His notion was that we, all of us, have different masks that we show the world, and that we take these masks off and put new ones on depending contextually on the situation we should find ourselves in. So that at the beginning of the day, I am wearing the mask of a good husband. And when I leave and I meet my friends, I wear the mask of a fun, active, interesting guy. And that when I meet a client at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I wear the mask of a serious, competent, icy cold professional. And this is important in personal computing because when you have control over these gestures, when you interact, your body is not relevant. It's not even germane to the conversation. You're basically interacting with the world through text, potentially through images, but at any event, with things that you have chosen, and you have this great ability to portray yourself the way that you want. Well, it's possible that none of these things are true of people using everywhere, which is represented by a picture for which I hope you'll excuse me. These people are not really using everywhere. But the interesting thing about this picture, as I thought about it, this is a picture of some friends of mine in San Francisco at lunch. And it's a little bit dark. You might not be able to see it terribly well. It's two gentlemen at a table in a restaurant with some implements and cutlery before them. And as I looked at this picture, it occurred to me that if everywhere truly does dissolve in behavior, there's nothing in this picture that could not be ubiquitous computing. So I'm going to ask you to imagine that it's 5 years from now. And in fact, this restaurant has a variety of ubiquitous devices and services running in it, which I will describe to you. The first one is embedded in the carafe of water. It is capable of measuring the degree to which that carafe is empty or full, and it is capable of communicating this to the kitchen so that when the carafe has become empty, a human waiter will come out and refill it. All of the cutlery and other implements have RFID tags or IPv6 addresses. They're capable of communicating their status and location with each other. And in fact, the tabletop has a menu in it, an old-fashioned kind of a menu, the menu that you order with in a restaurant, not the menu that you manipulate a computer with. So these guys are having lunch, but they're also using this extraordinarily sophisticated technical armature that they're not even necessarily aware of. One of my main points about everywhere is that users may not knowingly be aware that they're engaged in a technical interaction at all. And in fact, that is the meaning of dissolving into behavior. There is nothing different about this lunch in the year 2010 that would be about the lunch in 2005, except for the fact that services are being delivered seamlessly and invisibly in the background, afforded by this extremely sophisticated presentation of information. The issue there is that they no longer think of it as technical, and they treat it differently. And I think this becomes important when we speak about privacy, because people are more wary of things that they know to be technical than things which have disappeared into the background of their lives. In an everywhere world, too, you see that there are many devices, systems, and services that impinge on each user and also on each other. So just by walking down the street, you could be subject to a personal biometric system. You could be scanned by the gateway of the transit system. There could be something embedded in the street or in the flooring beneath you. You could be touching other haptic interfaces, tangible interfaces in the environment around you. The lampposts and the other features of the streetscape could have informational services appended to them. And last but not least, there is this surveillance element. There is a UAV here, a robotic helicopter, which is also surveying the cityscape and communicating with all of those devices. This is really what I mean by a transformation of the relationship between user and device. This person is not a user anymore in any real sense of the English word. They are a subject. They are subject to their negotiation of all of the fields of computation that they're exposed to as they move through the world. And because of this, we see that whereas with a personal computer, the body is all but irrelevant, in everywhere, users' positions matter very much indeed. And here's another picture where, again, it's maybe a little bit unfair of me. I'm cheating. Perfectly conventional picture taken on the street in Berlin in 2005. But I'm going to ask you to imagine that that is a smart map. That is a sheet of paper that has a map interface on it that's being used simultaneously by four users. Well, unless that map has been designed very crudely, it's going to matter that each of the four people around it are looking at it from a different perspective. Maybe it's as simple as the labeling on the map is turned so that it's legible, it's readable by somebody standing in their position. Maybe it's that the map actually reacts in real time to the direction that you hold it and turn it. But in any event, this is a stand-in for a much larger class of circumstances in which, far from being irrelevant, your location, your position, your orientation, the way you're facing, are all at the heart of the computational transaction. They are, in fact, the very cause of it. And we know this about the world. We know that there are important social and political meanings that are frequently associated with where you should happen to be in the world. This particular example is at Charles de Gaulle Airport in Paris, and we know from any airport that there is a very meaningful distinction between being outside security, or being on what's called dirt side, and being on the other side of that line, being on the air side. So all of a sudden, when computation invests spaces and our bodies become relevant to it, it's capable of having social and political effects in the world on a very large scale, in very, very large-scale public spaces. And for all of these reasons, we lose control over the presentation of self. Because when all of these sources are gathering information and representing it to one another, these facts can, once information goes into the system, whether it's from a personal monitor or a helicopter flying overhead or from something buried in the flooring here, it is potentially infinitely reproduced throughout the entire grid of computational devices that are connected to it, unless some very, very strong and clear security measures are taken. And we know from studying the ecology of computational devices in the wild right now that those security measures are not effective 100% of the time. Maybe they're only effective 99.99% of the time, but that still leaves a great deal of default to be experienced by human beings.